Well, hello there, everyone. Welcome to the Team Yume Gamecast. This is Madhog the Master, and for the first time, we have Ross Ferris on board for this particular iteration of the Team Yume podcast. It's a spin-off, I just decided. Yes.
Fantastic.
So, tonight we have actually a surprisingly busy schedule, and by busy schedule I mean we thought about talking about something like a day ago, and then something else was added at the very last second, because it's topical. And so, there we go. So,
we're going... Oh, topical!
Yes, very topical. So, we're going to start off by talking of a rather beloved, personally beloved fighting game. In fact, I dare say it's possibly my most favorite fighting game of all time, which isn't saying much. I haven't played all that many fighting games in my gaming life. We're going to discuss about Skullgirls, the indie darling that soared its way through popular cult success.
And of course, the most recent variation of the game, the second encore.
Yes, well, I'm going to primarily be talking about that since I actually recently acquired that version of Skullgirl for Steam. While Ross might be actually more stuck on the past version of the game, because he does not have the complete second encore set, which, spoiler alert, it's great. It feels like a complete game, for once.
I reviewed Skullgirl's second encore already.
Are you sure? You told me before you only had the mechanical version of Misfortune as an additional character.
No, I had... I got everything except Squiggly, which I didn't really care about.
Oh, well, that's great, because I do have Squiggly.
Oh, okay.
So there's that. Okay, so as I was saying, I'm going to be talking about the complete second encore of Skullgirl, and Ross, the 1.5 encore, I guess. 1.75 of second encore. Oh boy. Actually, Squiggly is not a very good character in terms of gameplay. At least I have some difficulties with her. But I do like and enjoy her design. And at the end of the day, that's pretty much the main reason why you should purchase a character in a fighting game. They really look nice. And let's face it, the art department of the Skullgirl game is top-notch and really one of its most prominent selling points. Would you agree with that?
I will say it definitely stands out from the fighting game crowd, which usually has this extremely heavy anime flavoring on it, and they really kind of can look samey. Only recently did something like Street Fighter start standing out when it moved to 3D models, and when everybody else was still using 2D sprites. But otherwise, as far as actual art designing everything, the Skullgirl's kind of faux 1950s design of everything mixed with kind of anime aesthetics really does work and make for a visually pleasing affair.
Yes, there are several subtle nuanced references to Art Deco, Art Nouveau, German Expressionism, and even Futurism, all coalescing together into these very defining artistic aesthetics that make the game stand apart from the competition. And it helps that the supposed fictional period of time in which Skullgirl seems to be setting seems to be an amalgamation of several various decades of the early 20th century.
Seems to include elements of the 20s, the 40s, and the 50s, if I really had to...
I'd say more prominently the 1920s, the 30s, and the 40s. You can see the heavy influences of both the jazz, the blues, and the swing musical movements, as well as the artistic movements that were popular at the time, which I mentioned a couple before. Uh-huh. And it's reflected both in the presentation and also in the choice of musical accompaniment.
Yes, although to the point it can also kind of not be super driving for a fighting game. A lot of it's very mellow, at least for the genre, which can kind of be almost counterintuitive to what you would be expecting. Although the my favorite tracks are actually the most driving ones, which are surprisingly the character select and the battle against the titular Skullgirl.
Well, I'd say yes, it's an unusual choice for a fighting game that's supposed to drive you into the moment of the fight and what have you. But I think it suits the game. I think it suits even the fighting of the game, because it's not proper swing or proper jazz. It's more of a modernized, more fast-paced version of the classic musical genre. And I appreciate that because it makes the game tonally and aesthetically consistent.
Mm-hmm. I don't know, maybe I just had Marvel vs. Capcom 2 flashbacks on it.
I'm gonna take you for a ride.
Da-da-da-da, because the soundtrack to that game was so unfitting of it.
Yes, well, you want to talk about unfitting soundtracks, MVC 2 is a very fitting example of that unfittingness.
But I digress, like, just the music style kind of took me back to that, and it was just like, But then, you know, there are some very good tracks in there. So, and again, it does mesh with the time period, the sort of parodying. So, it's fine.
Yes, and speaking of which, I like the attention to details that this game has, especially when it comes to the various posters, because every character seemed to have its own, their own personalized posters, so to speak, that present them in a certain light that makes them immediately recognizable as characters and their respective archetypes. For example, some character might have a poster inspired from an actual movie release of the time. I seem to recall a specific reference to Fritz Lang's Metropolis, which, as a film buff myself, I find it very deserving of appreciation.
Again, something that goes over my head because I'm really not a film buff at all.
Yes, generally speaking, I really appreciate, again, the art department and the character design in tune with the supposed mixture of time periods and the reference to artistic movements and films and compositions that were prominent in the supposed period that this game
I think we really should actually start talking about the characters.
Absolutely, the characters really drive the point home in terms of design, which is brilliant for the most part. What's your favorite character, by the way, Ross?
Eliza.
Eliza, really? It's okay, I understand. It seems too much.
She's so out there.
Okay, well, to be honest, every character in this freaking game is completely out there. From the fact that you have a real-life Fleischer-era cartoon character turn into murder machine.
Yes, or... Peacock.
Peacock is the best character, I will...
Peacock is the most iconic character of Skullgirls, I will give it that.
Well, that and Misfortune, because Catgirl with detachable body parts. Now, I think Peacock is brilliant, not just from a design standpoint, which is a clear reference to classic golden age Hollywood cartoons from the Fleischer brothers to Tex Avery. She has a cartoon bird companion called Avery, by the way, which is also a very clear reference. Right on the mark, I would say, but I really, really like the idea behind this character. She's like this twisted, deformed, cruel parody of, again, a classic cartoon of the 1920s and 1930s, with the classic design, cartoon gloves, and super deformed physical shapes. And she was made this way after being horribly mutilated, ice caved in, literally, and experimented on, turned into some sort of mechanical, biological hybrid of pure cartoony death.
Yes.
I find it so fascinating because I'm also a big fan of contrasting juxtapositions. You have the seeming wackiness and silliness of a Fleischer-era style cartoon.
With a very tragic story.
In perfect contrast with, as you put it, a really tragic backstory. A tragic backstory that, alas, I would have loved to learn more about. And that's kind of a problem with the story mode of this game, as well as, well, all story modes of every fighting game ever made.
You mean the lack of story in the story modes?
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, I see snippets, I see potential for great narratives for each and individual of these very interestingly designed characters, but we don't have the time to properly develop said stories. Basically, you can beat the story mode in 10 minutes if you're really good. So,
well, with any individual characters, yes. I mean, we're not talking like... These are basically arcade modes in most fighting games. I mean, they are not like full fleshed out, like huge story horrific endeavors. This isn't like Blaze Blue. This isn't like Mortal Kombat and Lane.
I'm going to be honest with you. The story mode in Blaze Blue can suck my...
Yes, I'm well aware of your hatred for that, but
it makes no sense whatsoever. Complete mess.
Oh, it is a glorious mess.
And it has the gall, the audacity, to end on a cliffhanger.
All of the games basically end on a cliffhanger, to my knowledge, which is annoying.
Unfortunately, that's what this one does. In fact, what is the story of Skullgirl? That's the main point, because so far, okay, fighting game narrative 101 says mysterious, all-powerful, non-specific MacGuffin shows up, fighters want it, they fight for it, the end.
That isn't inaccurate to Skullgirl's storyline, but basically it's more or less a battle over a monkey's paw.
Well, like I said, every fighting game tend to have that basic narrative thread. It works so well for a game in which you had to fight your way in one-on-one combat situations.
Yes.
Basically, every fighting game feels like a tournament arc with a specific prize at the end.
Pretty much. Skullgirls, if I had to pick just one game that I wish someone would sit down and actually make an expanded, like, book or comic series or a television series or fucking anything to flesh this shit out, Skullgirls would be the thing that I would choose.
Well, me too. Not only because it would really look well as an animated series because of its very unique and distinguishable style, but also because I think each and every character deserves more in terms of expanding narrative, because like I said before, there are snippets of potential and very interesting and grandiose narratives.
Hell, you saw where Eliza's story ended. Like, that was like the biggest freaking cliffhanger you could possibly do.
So the problem with most fighting games is that usually when you play a character's own story mode, then the next character's own story mode throws the previous story mode out of canon. Because every time you play a different story mode for every character, it feels like the world is resetting and things go in a different way, and you don't know which story is the proper one and which cliffhanger is the proper one, and basically you don't know what's going on.
So basically, if the game has a clear main character, again, or like, for example, Liu Kang in Mortal Kombat, well, Liu Kang's story is going to be the canon one. So to speak, Ryu's story in Street Fighter is going to be the canon one.
Not necessarily one main character. Everybody can be a main character. What I would like about this is that every story will be actually interconnected in a way that they will all collide at a specific point. I don't want every story to be a reset from the start that completely goes against what happens in another story.
But then you get things like Blaze Blue.
There has to be
a happy middle, I know.
There has to be a way to do that without it becoming completely confusing, because Blaze Blue actually cheats. Openly cheats, because it does all that. It resets the narrative every time, but it pretends that it's part of a bigger plot because there is actual time travel in it, which is stupid!
Yeah, you really shouldn't open your franchise with a time loop. That's kind of a bad idea.
Sailor Moon!
No, to be fair, that was freaking season 2 where they pulled... Like, the B-plot is time travel.
Well, okay then. So
it's still
that.
Bad, but yeah, I mean, I really do enjoy Skullgirls, and because Adrian is probably not really going to touch upon this much, I did want to talk about it mechanically a bit.
Yes, you do that, please. I was just waiting for you to get in and cover the technical side of things, because there's only so much I can say about that without sounding like a complete noob, which, to be fair, I kind of am.
Now, disclaimer, I'm not, like, a super heavy fighting game player. I'm still on the casual side, but I can at least understand and appreciate the final nuances of a game, even if I cannot string together a 32-hit combo.
I cannot even string together a 2-4 hit combos, honestly. That's how you call it? Hit combo, combo chain, combination of moves.
Yes.
If you want me to sound like an alien, combination of moves.
Sure. Okay. So Skullgirls was built by people whose favorite fighting game was Marvel vs. Capcom 2.
Oh, gee, you don't say.
Which has long been a darling of the fighting game community, but is, for as high as it's lauded, is also kind of a broken nightmare. Because basically, if you've ever followed the competitive scene in Marvel vs. Capcom 2, of the massive 40-something characters in this game, only 6 of them ever see competitive play. That's how bad the game is broken on that type of level. So one of the main things that they were trying to do when they set out to make this game is they're like, we are going to try to balance this game as best as possible, and we are going to try to remove a lot of the traps that Marvel vs. Capcom 2 fell into mechanically. Specifically, for a quick example, if your opponent manages to string together an infinite combo on you, the game recognizes this and actually give you a one button out. You just tap any button, the combo's broken. Because the game's small enough to recognize they're doing an infinite repeating combo on you. And of course, you can definitely see the Marvel vs. Capcom 2 roots on the 3-on-3 fighting engine that's in here. And I will say, from my experience with the game, most of the characters do seem to be fairly balanced with one another. Again, I have not seen super high-level play of Skullgirls, so I can't tell what the tiers would be in this game, but they seem to be a lot more balanced than Marvel vs. Capcom 2 ever was. That being said, mechanically it plays almost exactly like Marvel vs. Capcom 2 as far as like just how the fighting engine feels and everything. But the problem with it is having a 3-on-3 potential fighting system feels kind of wasted when you only have 20 characters to select from at best.
Well, in the second encore, you have a full cast of 20 characters, which...
Yeah, if you had older versions of the game, you had, like, 12.
Yeah, you know, the first time I purchased this game, because I had to purchase this game multiple times for reasons, was when I still had my PlayStation 3. before it broke down. I actually purchased the game at the time of its original release, so I had the basic of the basic of the bare bones version of that game.
Which I think was like 8 characters.
Yes, well, the main cast, basically, all 8 of them. Yes. I like the fact that this game was successful enough to basically warrant an expansion upon it. I'm actually glad to find it again here on Steam, on my computer. I finally get the chance to play a complete game with more stories to tell, which will end in a very confusing note that doesn't really solve anything. More characters to play as and more artwork to unlock and to enjoy in its various nuanced references to pre-existing art movements of the early 20th century. Which, so, again, I can enjoy on a different level.
But yeah, we still haven't really gone over the characters.
Yes, we mentioned Peacock and Eliza. You said that Eliza was your favorite character. I think she,
it is.
I think she's kind of an easy choice, really. Too easy for me. She's a Cleopatra-themed, immortal parasite god or divinity with basically detachable skin. And
blood.
She has a literal pool of blood and servants that are based off Egyptian gods, obviously.
I mean, even if you don't claim that she's your favorite, how can you not love this character?
All the characters seem to have some sort of nuances or weight, backstory, dimensions and layers. Eliza is just one-dimensionally super evil with no redeeming qualities. She just wants to conquer the world, basically. That's her character. That stands out in a game like this.
Again, it's just such a trippy concept for a character. One that literally can detach its bones and attack you with it independently.
Honestly, after the detachable cat girl, that's not so novel. In fact, all characters are so delightfully out there that they will conquer your heart with their wackiness.
Yes, we've already gone over how much of a fan of Beowulf you are.
Beowulf just makes me so happy. I am yet to play his story mode at this specific point in time, but I bet it's going to be chock full of delightful wrestling references.
I am.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. Okay, so this is beautiful. Skullgirls, as far as I know, is the only game that allows you to pit a Fleischer-era cartoon character against a pro wrestler. This makes me happy. I mean, just saying that, just saying that sentence that I just said, this makes me so happy. What other game allows you to do that? I don't know. So, I cannot wait to learn more about Beowulf. Okay, speaking of attention to details, I am really appreciative of his motions during a fight. You know when he backs away from an opponent, he does the come and get me hand motion that you would expect someone like The Rock to do, basically? Uh-huh. That's lovely. He fights with a steel chair.
Yeah.
He does an RKO on the chair. That's so good, so good. That makes me so happy. I am slightly less happy with the character of the giant saxophone man, which
Big
is
Big Band. Yeah, he's not really a fave of mine either.
Well, here's the thing: he's fun to play. Yes, he's obviously the strongest character in the roster, but it's not so good to fight against. He's a bit broken, isn't he?
He can be pretty busted, but it also depends on how good you are at comboing because he's such a big target.
Okay, so he has a mid-range attack, long-distance attack, short-range attack. He hits like the Hulk.
But most characters are speedier than him. Like, he's going to lose, like, a match against Misfortune, like, almost every time.
Yes, but you try to fight him 2 against 1. This is an interesting aspect of this game that we are yet to discuss. You can do handicap matchups. The real kicker here is that if you're doing, for example, a 2 against 1 handicap match, the handicap is not for the one, the handicap is for the team of 2, because mm-hmm. they are far weaker than the one.
Correct. In that sense. Because basically all of those stats go down massively.
Yes. So there's that. And I tried to fight Big Bam with a team comprised of Squiggly and And Pain Wheel, which incidentally I'm not very good at either of those characters. So
Pain Wheel feels like the Voldo of this game. I mean, he really reminds me of Voldo from Soul Calibur.
Is that a good or a bad thing?
It's a neutral thing. It's just a bizarre character to play. And I was never really good with Voldo, so I never really fell into a groove with Pain Wheel.
I see.
I will say that this game is really cheap for a fighting game of its caliber, because it's technically an indie game, but at least it has indie roots. It's retailing for like $15 American over here, which is a bargain.
Well, here's the kicker to the kicker that I kicked before. I actually purchased this game in a special indie bundle offer.
One of those, the humble bundles.
No, it's another kind of bundle, but I don't remember the name of. Basically, they sold this game, along with several other games, for a total price of $3.
Yeah, I love it when they do that. That's the one thing I will give Steam over, like, consoles any day, is when you get a sale like that, you make out.
Oh, yes, Skullgirls, oh, yes, the love of my life. I'm making out.
I'm
metaphorically making out. You know, it would be great if they added Marie, the actual, you know, titular Skullgirl of Skullgirls, as a
playable character.
Yes, I don't see why they couldn't.
I don't know, maybe because mechanically it would be unbalanced.
Well, you know, it wouldn't be the first time they had a playable character as a final boss in a fighting game.
It wouldn't be the first time, by gangs. The team behind Skullgirls was adamant about trying to balance everything.
Okay. They also went out of their way to add a joke character in the game that's completely out of canon compared to the rest of the game, which is the green-haired clone of the character Ophelia called Fuqua.
Yes.
Which is a joke that I don't get, but maybe you want to explain?
I can explain the joke for you. Okay, so in many, many, many fighting games, there are characters that are either functionally the same, like, say, Ryu and Ken from Street Fighter. They're very, very similar.
I'm aware of that.
Or in outright color swaps of the same characters.
I'm also aware of that.
Combat. Well, this was kind of a stab at how many fighting games with very large rosters will have so many samey characters. Again, let's bring up Marvel vs. Capcom 2 again. Let's see, so you have Akuma, Ryu, Ken, Morgan from Darkstalkers. These characters are so functionally similar that you could just have one of them to fulfill that role.
Yes, so Fuqua is a satirical stab on that whole concept. I get
it. Exactly, and they released it as a free, even for the original version of the game, a free download on April Fool's Day.
Okay, you know, I played the story mode of Fuqua out of curiosity. It's literally just an arcade mode with no story whatsoever.
And, except that the final battle of that will kick your ass.
I know!
Ophelia's not nice!
It's really hard. I mean, okay.
Let me run through the rest of Skullgirls story modes with no problem, but yes, my god!
Okay, so basically, I was cruising through all the selection of fighters that Fuqua was dealing with. Which...
So I also could fight all the DLC up to that point, even if you didn't have
that. And then comes Ophelia, and oh my gosh, I must have fought her about 20 times before finally finding a ridiculously convoluted strategy in order to beat her, and that's pretty much the only time in this game in which I had to carefully strategize my every single move in order to beat her. And fun fact, the Fuqua story mode is the first story mode that I actually played.
Oh no!
Yes!
I'm so sorry!
And Skullgirls. I mean, I had set the difficulty to easy because I was still relearning the controls. But my gosh, I might as well set it to nightmarish impossible difficulty. It was that hard. Okay, so basically, every time she attacks me, mid-air attack, I activate the move that allows me to catch her in mid-air. Uh-huh. Basically, when the hair turns into a couple of pinchers.
Yes.
Yes. Then every other move was basically the one move that she does when she's one knee on the ground and she forms this vehicle of death with her hair.
Mm-hmm. That's what she does. She does everything with her hair.
Yes. I had to do a combination of those two moves and keep myself as distant as possible from her impossible to break combos. And that's how I eventually beat her. My gosh, that was ridiculous. And you know, one thing, that's not even the most difficult boss in the entire game.
No, no, I mean, the titular Skullgirl can be a rat bastard if you don't know your character terribly well going in.
Actually, I was not talking about that particular iteration of Marie. I was talking about Marie 300%.
Oh yeah, that one.
That exists. Okay, so basically I go to the menu screen, I go to the settings, and I see an option called Marie 300%. It turns out it's a teaser for the eventual story mode of Squiggly, which at the time this was added, it was apparently yet to come. So we have Squiggly herself telling the fans that her story is yet to come. So Marie comes, and she's pissed off because her story is not available yet, and she hates to be trolled. So she turns into the mega evolution of herself, and she is unbeatable.
Yeah!
And especially if you had to fight her with Squiggly.
Oh no, yeah, Squiggly is not good in my opinion. I mean, I guess someone could use her well, but not me.
I promptly gave up on that. I'm pretty sure the payoff is not worth the stress and life-shortening struggle.
Right. But then again, bullshit final bosses is a big part of fighting games, unfortunately.
Honestly, the regular final boss for every single individual story mode is actually fair once you, you know, memorize what her repertoire is.
Yeah, Marie, for most characters, is not too bad.
You know, I said that I like Peacock, but I am not very good with her.
Oh, so she's a straight zoning character, so basically you have to keep your opponent at range the entire time.
So basically, to fight Marie, I hit her with the cartoon cannon.
Oh, so you didn't do Garbage Day all day?
No. I just kept my distance and hit her with the cannon up until she dies. That's what I did.
Well, it's cheap, I guess it worked. Hey, that you know how I started out playing Marvel vs. Capcom 2? No lie, I picked Mega Man and Roll, and I would just spam projectiles.
Yes,
that's
well,
all I did.
It's a viable learning tool, I guess.
I mean, that just takes me back. I was like, okay, well, I can't play a fighting game, so I'll play a platformer.
Yes. Well, it's nice that the game allows you to cheat like that. So, there's that. Anyway, so that was our Skullgirls discussion. I think we said everything that needed to be said. It's a great and fine game to play. It has its flaws, but deep gameplay action and really interesting and unique art style make more than up for its shortcomings, in our opinions.
Hey, at least it has more content than Street Fighter V.
Oh, whatever. I said at the beginning of this podcast I have not played many fighting games, but here's the ones that I did play. Marvel vs. Capcom 2, obviously.
Uh-huh.
Blaze Blue, obviously, because yes. I talk trash about it. I don't know if Super Smash Bros. Brawl counts as a fighting game, but I'll say that it does.
I count it as one.
So there's that. Oh, Arcana Hearts, weirdly enough.
Yeah, well, Arcana Heart 3 of all things.
Of all things, yes. That's the one. That's the one that I played.
Arcana Heart 3 is the easy one. You should have seen what came before it. Oh my god, you want to talk about impossible final battles?
Not really.
Jeez. Like, yeah. I still can't be Arcana Heart 1 to this day with any character. I'm not even kidding.
Oh boy. I think I might have played... I played Soul Calibur 3 at some point.
Okay, that was the one that had the real-time strategy game kind of tacked onto it, right?
I'm not sure I know what you're talking about.
So Soul Calibur 3 had... Its story mode was basically like a combination fighting game, real-time strategy game, except it was extremely slow and plodding and really boring.
I think it might have been the case, actually.
If you went to the fighting game, like, okay, I'm going to play a fighting game. Why am I sitting here watching horses beat down a castle?
Yeah, well, hybrids don't usually work for a variety of reasons, especially if the hybridated games really do not match each other's style. If you're doing a hybrid with a fighting game and a strategy game, you better make sure that the strategy can keep up with the fighting part. Otherwise, you might as well just do the umpteenth iteration of Dynasty Warriors and be done with it.
Exactly. I was just like, I'm playing it and just like, oh god, I wish I was playing Dynasty Warriors instead.
Honestly, I think Dynasty Warriors would bore me after 5 minutes of doing the same bloody two things over and over again.
Oh, it's repetitive as shit. I'm not even going to try to say otherwise, but sometimes you're just in the mood to take down armies of dudes.
I like God of War. I like the way God of War did that. It had variety every time you kill somebody.
Well, keep in mind God of War also was very puzzle-heavy too, which kind of took away from the bloodshed.
Well, you know, the puzzles were clever. Not always, but it's an action-adventure game. So anyway, we're done with Skullgirls.
I'm the wildest there is, was, and ever will be.
Now you're cooking with gas.